Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys, girls, and sentient robots. My name is Nick, and this broadcast is brought to you in glorious golden edition. Today on Let's Chat Comics number 3, we're joined by a superhuman special guest, Dylan, a.k.a. RM Alexander. Dylan, how you doing, bud?
I'm doing great.
Really glad you could join us, man. You're a very busy guy. Your channel is awesome. What's the link? Can you remind us real quick?
It is, you can either go to youtube.com/Aurum, A-U-R-A-M, chaos, or you can go to aurum.me/YouTube.
Either one. Sounds pretty easy to me. We're also joined by, as usual, contributor for the weekly poll and nerd feed, our very own Owen Likes Comics. Owen, how you doing, man?
What's going on, guys? I'm still Tom Machine getting a beer with Batman or a soda with Superman, but I want to talk comics.
Well, I mean, Superman has to drink soda because he can't get drunk. He can't drink beer. Is that the problem?
The problem was that script was terrible. But you'll all get to see that next week for Development Hell Discussions.
Yeah, I have no idea what you're talking about. I didn't see it or anything like that. I have no idea. So Let's Chat Comics is the show where we review 2 comics each and we tell you whether you should pick up the individual issues or if you should wait for the trade. Let's Chat Sex Criminals. Let's Chat Sex Criminals, written by Matt Fraction and illustrated by Chip Zdarsky. The dynamic duo presents us with a beautiful world of a sexually powered criminal couple, John and Susie. In this magical world, this couple must get off in order to power up, meaning they must, achieve orgasm in order to slow down time to a complete crawl. The quiet, as Susie calls it, or cum world, as John much less romantically calls it. I love this book and all of its like raunchy glory in all of its like, you know, satire and stuff like that. I mean, the book is wonderfully written. It's got great interactions between the main characters. Matt Fraction is very talented when it comes to writing female parts and making them very dynamic and interesting and strong on their own right without like, he doesn't cop out by saying like, all right, I want to make this character interesting, so I'm going to make her super flawed and I'm going to make her really dysfunctional. Like, this is no spoiler because it happens pretty much in the first 2 pages of the book, but Susie's father commits suicide. He jumps out of a window. He's kind of like a stockbroker or something like that, or insurance salesman. Yeah. Can't deal with the grief, kills himself. So she's kind of left to raise herself and, you know, left to grow up at a very early age. She discovers through, kind of doing a little funkiness downstairs, that she can slow down time if she achieves orgasm. Long story short, she finds John, who's able to do the same thing, who calls it like a really weird name as well. We went over that earlier. I'm not going to repeat it. They eventually figure out that they can like slow down time and do shit. So John starts to take shits in his boss's like plant, his potted plant. He likes to slow down time and then go over there and like plop one down real quick. These minor crimes and minor incidents, like as you can imagine, kind of escalate until they get to the point where they're robbing banks and stuff. And they find that there are a ton of other people in the world that have the same power. It's really interesting the way they present it because it's kind of like, it's very satirical and it's a huge parody on not only comics, but like the world around us. Like, for instance, they have a service that's not Ask Jeeves, but Ask Jeeves. And it's like, it's the, you know, butler with the booty hanging out and stuff like that. And like, there's, if you buy the trade, the full book, the volumes, there's like really awesome writings in the back from Matt Fraction, Zdarsky. And Zdarsky's talking about how he had to draw like just hundreds of dildos throughout the process of making this book, and it was kind of like weird and strange because they're very professional people and this is like a book that you couldn't release on any other, you know, publisher than Image. But yeah, it's a really fantastic book. The characters, there has to be an antagonist, as you imagine, also have sex powers and they can slow down time and do all kinds of crazy things, but what they do is they stop people from committing crimes. They go as far as to have like the Bruce Wayne of the quiet, as it were. He's like a fancy guy that dresses up in a suit and walks around, but he's like fully masked and he's like going based on fear. It's a really awesome book. I highly recommend it to everybody. Right now, I think they're up to issue 14. I've only read up to volume 2, so I think that's like issue 12 or so. I'm not quite sure. I have to check on it. But highly recommended. Owen, does this sound like something you would read?
Why would it be something I'd read? What do you think of me?
Hey, I'm doing the show, man. We gotta go. I gotta ask you, because if I just ask, like, hey, is this something you guys would read? It was like crickets.
On a more serious note,
I don't think you're a pervert or anything.
Well, you don't know me well enough yet. But on a serious note, from what you've explained to me today and what you were telling me off camera the other day, this sounds like a really cool book and something I'd really like to read. It's such a unique take on kind of the superhero concept mixed with some kind of adult comedy. And I think that's a really interesting recipe. And, you know, like you said, only at Image could we get something as weird and as abstract as Sex Criminals.
If I may interject really fast, Scott down there, NerdSync, says that he couldn't really get into the book. He picked up about half of it and then dropped it. Honestly, I had to read this a couple times and it started like wearing on me more and more, you know, like, hey, you know, I was thinking about that character the other day, and it took me a little while to read through the entire thing the first time, but then I picked it up the second time and just flew through the whole damn thing. Arm, what do you think about this? Should I refer to you as Dylan or Arm? Like, because if I say Arm, it plugs your channel.
But, Arm works, Dylan works, either one works.
I'll go with Dylan, because like I like to be friendly, man. Yeah.
Cool. So I haven't read Sex Criminals, but I've heard a lot about it, and every single time someone describes it to me, I realize that I forgot the premise beforehand. So every time someone explains it to me, I'm like, whoa, what? Wait, I do remember this.
Yeah, yeah.
But the only reason I know about the book is because Matt Fraction's attached to it. And I love Matt Fraction. He's amazing. Mm-hmm. So,
and you get really cool, like, Matt Fraction-style covers, you know? Mm. Like, the stream is checking them out right now. They're just, you actually mentioned that Invincible Iron Man is one of your favorites.
Yep.
Over on your channel. Little plug, go check out Arm Chaos on YouTube. and you get all that Matt Fraction feel, all that, like, you know, real personal drama there. It's really cool, man. I really, really suggest it. So let's keep moving on, because we got a lot of books to talk about today. The next book that we're going to be doing, if I may switch over here. This one I really liked. I actually read it in preparation for this. It's a freaking great book. That's highly recommended. Deadpool Secret Wars, number 2. Dylan has graciously given up one of his potential video topics, or actually two of his potential video topics, chat about it right here, right now, which is incredibly generous. So, Dylan, please, would you tell us what you thought of the current run of Deadpool Secret Wars? I thought it was really great. Let's break it down.
All right. So, first off, I may have mistyped earlier, and I probably should have went back and told you about this, but number 3 came out this week.
Yeah.
So, I read issue 3. Here it is. It's
well,
beautiful.
Your slideshow actually has images from issues 1 through 3, which I read.
Oh,
all.
Oh, cool.
Friggin' awesome. So,
okay, sweet.
Fire away, man. It's the series is yours.
All right. Awesome. So I've got some notes here. It's written by Colin Bunn and Matteo Lolli. He's the artist, I think. And basically, the premise of it is the 1984 Secret Wars event happened before Deadpool was created. So now that Secret Wars is happening, and spoilers, I guess, Deadpool's dead in the current universe, they're retconning Deadpool to appear in the original Secret Wars event.
Yeah.
So, It's
hard to talk about it without giggling a little bit.
Yeah, it's a very interesting premise, and at first I thought what they were gonna do with it is just kind of shove Deadpool into the original Secret Wars event and nobody would notice him. But some of the characters are interacting with him now, and especially in like issue 3, it's kind of taking a dark turn.
Yeah, I love the setup. You know, I'm trying not to spoil it too much, but
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, we're talking about it. I mean, so the end of issue 2 ends with like this, you know, they have the shields with like have images that display like what's going to happen in the future. And essentially, like, it kind of gives a little tell as to what's going to happen. It just has this classic like 1980s style final panel of what's going to happen in the next issue. And it just it made me feel warm fuzzies, you know?
Yeah. And I love the if I could just. I want to just briefly touch on something specific in issue 3 because I loved it. The cover has Deadpool in a very, very interesting black costume, and in the outfit there's the secret origin of a certain symbiote is revealed, and it's pretty great. That's all I'll say about that.
All right. So, would you recommend this book? Do you recommend picking up each issue, or would you get the trade?
I would, I'd say just, if you can now, go pick up the, there's only three issues out right now, so I would get the three while you can still read it with all the other Battle Worldy stuff going on.
Yeah. So, and it's a cool because it's a reminder of what happened in 1984 Secret Wars. Have you checked that out?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and it's like he absorbs the Beyonder, and like everything that happens in Secret Wars happens except with Deadpool there, which is mm-hmm. really interesting. And I think there are clues in that if you go back and see, you know, what has happened in the previous Secret Wars. Like, it may be a little mm-hmm. bit difficult to read the, like, Secret Wars 84 was actually the second one, if I'm not mistaken. And, like, it was a little weird. Like, there were some parts that just seemed silly. Like, you know, Captain... I mentioned this before on the show, but, like, Captain America putting a shield together just by hand somehow and reassembling it. It's like, look, good as new. I use super glue. It's like, it's fucking vibranium, though. but, yeah, so cool. Owen, what do you think about Deadpool's Secret Wars from what you've heard so far?
You see, the thing for me with Deadpool is he's a cool character, but... Now, I kind of have the unpopular opinion. I find him to be a bit of a one-note character. There's only so much you can do with him. Mm-hmm. That being said, everyone that I spoke to about Deadpool Secret Wars has said it's really good. Said it's one of the best tie-ins at the moment. That and Old Man Logan, which I also should probably read. But
we'll get into that later. I'll try not to spoil too much for you.
But just talking about Deadpool right now, you know, I think this is a really cool premise. You know, I love the original 1984 Secret Wars. And I'll probably love it even more with Deadpool in. So I'm definitely going to pick this up in trade.
Yeah. You know, it's something cool, though, because we have an appreciation for Secret Wars 1984. The art style is very similar. It's like really throwbacky, but it's kind of like a modernization, slight update on the printing, on the ink itself. It just the art is just great. But yeah. So let's move on to our next comic of the day. Blah, 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 blah. If I can speak English and host a show at the same time, Superman. Don't care, oh. Owen.
I will defend.
I'm sorry, dude. I don't. But make me care, man. I'm interested to hear you be excited about it. You're my friend. I like to hear my friends be happy about things. So, what did you like about it, Owen? What do you think?
I'm sure my role on Let's Chat Comics is literally just to stick up for Superman.
Pretty much. There's a really big crowd out there. We got to appeal to everybody.
So, just to somewhat. For those of you who might not be reading, over in Action Comics, which is kind of the main Superman book at the moment, Superman's lost his powers and he's dealing with the effects of that. Over here in Gene Yang's Superman book, this is kind of the prequel to that. This is how he's lost his powers. And I won't go into too much spoilers, but picking up where we left off, we're introduced to kind of the main villains of the book, which is a group known as the Hordor Corporation, which is described as kind of like a gang, kind of like a tech company, and they wear like Court of Owl masks. And basically, what they do is they hack people's secrets and use them to blackmail people. And the blackmailing Clark, they know his secret identity and they're using it to blackmail him. And so Clark, with Lois, with Jimmy, and with this mysterious woman, they go to their headquarters and they track them down. Mm. And the big reveal in this episode, in this issue, sorry, and it's a slight spoiler, but it's in all the previews, you should probably see it right now. Lois tells Clark that she knows that he's Superman and that she has done for a while.
Right. Is that, I don't know a lot about DC, so is that a thing that, is that so like since New 52, Lois hasn't known?
In yeah, New I was 52, always under the impression that she kind of knew, at least yeah, in a few, you know, the, universes.
In the New 52, the Lois-Clark relationship is very different because they're not dating.
Oh. Oh,
they're literally okay. Just work friends. Clark's with Wonder Woman.
Oh.
And has been for the entirety of the New 52. So they're just...
Fair trade, yeah.
They're just really close friends. Yeah, I'll take it. But she... It's always been because Lois has been... You know, she came to fame writing all these articles about Superman. She was the one that kind of gave him the name. You know, she's like the main reporter for Superman. So her saying that she's known it's been Clark for a while is quite a big reveal. And as I said, I won't go into spoilers because there's a lot more that happens this issue. But it's very action-packed and... A lot of people have been critical of John Romita Jr.'s art in this, but I think it looked really good this issue. I was quite impressed. He seems to have stepped up his game.
The particular slide that's up right now looks especially bad, but everything else looks kind of cool. Like, yeah, I don't know where the fuck this thing comes from. You'll watch it in post, Owen, but yeah. The rest of it's really cool looking, though.
I'm not the biggest fan of John Romita Jr.'s art.
Mm. You see, personally. It seems to be, when he's at Marvel, he does really good work, but it has seemed for a lot of his Superman run, he's been phoning it in. But I think... there is some nice panels in this. And overall, if you like Superman, if you like the direction Superman's going, this is kind of essential because it's filling in the gaps. If you don't like Superman, if you don't like the direction Superman's going in, this probably isn't the book for you, in all honesty.
Well, I like the idea that they're introducing Superman with, like, I guess, an invisible enemy. An enemy he can't fight that's, like, blackmailing him. So he can't just go up to this thing. He can't go up to blackmail and punch it. You know what I mean? So that's kind of cool. And I appreciate the more, like, psychological stories with Superman. So this might kind of be interesting to pick up, but I don't know, man. I'm still like, really on the fence about Superman. I'm not going to say he sucks because, like, it really depends on the writer. It depends on the artist. So I'm not going to go that far, but yeah, I might check it out. You recommend picking up individual issues or buying the trade?
I'd go with the individual issues for now because I'm not quite sure where this story is going to go. Because the first issue wasn't that great, but the second issue was pretty good. So we'll see.
Yeah. Right on. Okay, so let's move on to our next topic of the day. I am excited for. Let's see. Let's get that over there. Right on. Wait, why is there... I've doubled. Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
Just one second. It's the joy of doing a live show. All right. And give a little room for edit. Star Wars 6 has introduced Mrs. Solo, and it's not Leia. The change in continuity makes it very, very interesting. While I was previously a bit annoyed about the amount of, like, shoehorned in fan service, it's starting to grow on me a little bit. The plot thickens. Dylan, are you digging Marvel's new canonical reboot of the Star Wars universe? Tell us.
Kinda.
I know, right? It's like, it's totally kind of. It has its moments. Do tell, though.
So the thing that you were talking about Miss Solo and all that I hated. The low point of the new Star Wars stuff for me so far.
Yeah.
But there have been, like, the series started out, the first three issues of that series started off, like, they were all right. They were kind of cool. I was like, ooh, Star Wars, yay. But it kind of picked up and then slowed down, and now I think it's picking back up again with the Obi-Wan stuff.
Yeah.
Which is awesome. The issue 7 is based on, the premise of it is that it's an excerpt from Obi-Wan's journal when he was on Tatooine, and it's when Luke is still, like, a youngin, and it's really cool just to see that the life of Tatooine from a different perspective that's not, like, out in the super desert with the moisture farmers and all that.
Yeah, if I may add in, it is very, very interesting. And they, like, these books, the one thing that they're doing right is world building, but, like, the whole plots and character stuff is kind of lackluster at points. Mm-hmm. But the world building is amazing. What you were saying about Tatooine is, like, you see, like, the you know, crime and scum and villainy that they always talk about in the films. It's actually, like, personified in everywhere, you know, and you see really cool things. But do continue.
Quickly touching on Tatooine again, is just people complain all the time about Tatooine is, like, in every film and we keep going back to it. And that's something I think this specific issue does really well, is we're back on Tatooine, but it shows us a different part so it doesn't feel stale.
You got it, yeah. What did you think about the issues beforehand? Because you were saying, like, and not so much, but, you know, Obi-Wan is kind of a new take on it a little bit. Yeah,
the issues before, I was, a lot of the times, like, specifically, like, I think in, like, 4 through 6, what they were doing was they would have Luke's story, which was really interesting, and then Han and Leia's story, which I didn't give two shits about. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want some Corellian wine? Fuck off!
I don't care about that. I felt kind of, like, cheated when I was buying, like, half of a book that I actually enjoyed, but I think it's starting to pay off a little bit, but...
a little spoiler alert, I mean, you know from Empire that eventually Vader figures out that Luke is his son. We're starting to see that happen a little bit in these latest issues of the comic, so it is starting to get cool. But I recently did a review on Vader, And, like, Vader was kind of cool, but then they introduced this female character. I honestly forget her name, and it's just, like, she's supposed to be a fan of Vader, and she's always fangirling out, which is what? Really annoying, and it's like, I don't want that with Vader. And I always kind of assumed that Vader was more of a walk into somewhere and cut people down kind of guy, you know? But they're trying to really, really strongly emphasize that Darth Vader is still Anakin. They're still part of him, and right. I don't fucking care. There is actually a panel on top of Vader where it's like illustrating one scene from Episode 2 where like they're on not Naboo, Thneed or one of those planets, and the whole fucking love scene with Hayden Christensen and you know, so they have that panel, and then like you know Vader, they show his face close up as though there's like a tear coming down. Like this, they don't show the tear, but like that's what they're like trying to show with it, and it's to see that. So overall, man, would you recommend sticking it out and seeing what happens? Like, do you want to see if this ties into the films on the road to Star Wars Force Awakens?
Personally, what I'm doing is I'm buying the single issues, but I'm only buying Star Wars. I'm not buying Darth Vader or Lando or any of that or the other stuff because
Lando's especially bad.
Is it? Okay. So I'm glad I didn't even try that then. But personally, I think issuating for this has been kind of annoying and bad, so I would trade weight this book if you really want to read Star Wars.
Right on. Owen, does this intrigue you at all?
See, I've heard very mixed things about the Star Wars comics. Some people are saying they love them, some people are saying they hate them. And I think that what stems from is the fact that all these books are canon, which means that if not done right, this could get very convoluted very quickly.
Oh yeah.
And from what I've heard, people are enjoying Vader, and as I said, I haven't read any of the Star Wars books, so I'm probably not the best person to comment. But this Han Solo's wife thing, from what I've heard of it, it really irks me, and it's not something I'm too keen on the sound of.
I'm fearing that it's like a shoehorning in of like, this is John Boyega's father, mother thing, you know, and I'm a little worried about that. Want to just take a moment to say hello to everybody in the chat, because it's been blowing up since I last looked over. Aaron Bess has joined us again. Greetings, my friend.
I just want to shout out to Aaron, who's pig at his phone.
Right.
So, let's hope you get a new phone or a better pig. Either one.
Wow. Like, do you think it digested the phone, or did it, like, just swallow? That's very curious. Well, let's move on to the next topic, though. We could talk about pigs all day long. Our next topic of the day is... Oh, Owen, this one's for you. Batman 42 has polarized the Batman fan person community because, you know, they're fans of all different kinds of, you know, naughty bits underneath their cosplay uniforms, whatever. Anyway, Commissioner Gordon has taken the place of the missing Bruce Wayne, a.k.a. Batman, donning a robotic suit to make up for his shriveled, cigarette-charred lungs. He doesn't want to be Batman, but he has to. Very intriguing. Owen, what can you tell us about Batman number 42?
Well, I'm only about 3 weeks late to picking this book up, so... But, you know, I didn't get Batman 41 because I wasn't keen on the sound of the new direction, but a lot of positive word of mouth thought, you know what, I'll read what happens online and I'll check out the next issue. So this is what I've done. So long story short, Gordon's in this position now with the GCPD and the Powers Corporation from Batman Beyond, because Wayne Enterprises has gone bust because Bruce isn't there. The whole company's gone under, and kind of this Powers Corporation have bought up what's left of it. And they're funding this Batman program, and because he knows Gotham more than anyone, he knows Batman more than anyone, Jim Gordon's kind of stepped into the role, and they've kind of de-aged Gordon a little bit. What this issue does really well, and what Scott Snyder does really well, he deals with a lot of our problems with this Batman. The fact that we don't like the suit. He doesn't act like Batman. He doesn't use the Batmobile. They deal with a lot of stuff. He does get a Batmobile in this book, which is awesome. Because it's not just a Batmobile. It's a Bat truck.
What?
It is a giant truck. And inside, it's essentially a mobile Batcave.
What?
It's his mobile command unit.
Okay, the sad fact that makes sense for a cop, you know?
The sad fact is, it is destroyed at the end of the issue. I'm sorry.
Aww.
In a fight with a supervillain. He uses it remote control to crush the villain.
That's lame.
And basically, what Gordon's doing at the moment is he's doing some work in the Narrows because there's been a series of killings against gang leaders, all using a seed, a radioactive seed, because comics are weird. And
that's, you know, you could do that. Okay, radioactive seed. Go on.
And what this issue kind of does, we see Gordon step away from being Gordon, starting to become Batman. There's a nice scene where he's in the morgue, because all nice scenes take place in morgues, with Captain Maggie Sawyer, where they're discussing this case, and Batman kind of just turns around and says, right, if you've got any more information, let me know, but leave it with me, as Bruce would. And Captain Sawyer reminds him, you know, you're not this vigilante Batman. Mm-hmm. She calls him a deputized Batman. You know, you work for the GCPD. So this isn't so much, it kind of, you know, this isn't Batman. As much as he wants to be, he still isn't Batman. But, and, you know, this issue also sets up the main villain for the series, who I won't delve too much into. It's a new character from what we sound like. Mm. We get a lot of, you know, the personal dilemmas that Gordon's having, because he's not sure if he's the right person to be doing this. He's not sure if he is Batman or if he's just a guy in a suit imitating Batman. And he kind of feels that people aren't taking him seriously because, well, he's not Batman.
Well, tell us a little bit more about this new villain, because I'm always intrigued by Batman villains. Like, that's kind of, like, I love Batman. That's one of my only, like, big, you know, things with DC. Honestly, I think that the villains are what makes Batman so cool. Is that, like, if Batman was just running around punching, you know, regular crooks, it would be boring, but he has really intricate plots with his villains doing all kinds of crazy things. So, what can you tell us about this new bad guy?
Well, let's set the scene a little bit. So, he's in his new bat truck, and not only does he have a bat truck, he has a bat app.
It's a bat app. Okay. You can download it now from the Apple Store.
And what the bat app does, it alerts him of any crimes in progress. So he heads over to the Narrows.
Yeah, it's called the police scanner. I have it too.
he heads over to the Narrows.
Stop interrupting. Sorry.
So he heads over to the Narrows and meets up with a villain called Ji Yi Hyung, who is leader of the Devil's Pig Division of the Chinese Mafia, and he has the ability to manipulate his molecular structure. So he's kind of like the Sandman, but it's any sort of building material. So he can tear up pavements and. It's some crazy stuff. It's not a character I'm overly familiar with. I don't know if it's someone that Scott Snyder's recently created or if it's an older character. But anyway, so there's some really cool fight scenes between the two of them. Eventually, Batman shoots him with like a thermal shock and he starts to implode. So what he does is he picks up the entire street, wraps it in the mech suit in Batman and throws himself into the ocean. So Gordon manages to fight out, throws him back onto the land. There's a lot of collateral. And
getting broken.
As what I'm going to describe as the devil sand monster, because he has horns on his head for some reason, which give him his powers. So it sounds like something Grant Morrison might have wrote. As he's about to kill him, Batman hits the remote control on his suit, and the bat truck comes crashing in and just splats him.
Nice. Well, that's a huge spoiler right there.
Well, it's not. He's pretty one note, but the impact of that is afterwards, because he's not dead. He's just very, very hurt.
Okay.
Because it turns out this guy also has the seed. So Gordon's questioning on it, and he says that, I think the line that he says is, Mr. Bloom is coming for you, Batman. So we learn that Mr. Bloom, whoever this is the one that's producing these seeds and is behind all these murders. And now he's targeting Batman. So whoever that is, if that's a new character or if that's a new name for an old character, we don't know. But it's nice to see that Gordon's getting his own villains.
Yeah.
And we get another character who shows up towards the end of the book. Duke Thomas makes an appearance. Who, for those of you who don't know, in the Future's End arc, he is Robin in the future after Damian. And he's also the main character in the We Are Robin book, which I haven't read.
I've heard good things. A lot of people are screaming about We Are Robin. It didn't seem intriguing to me, a bunch of like Robin.
And I'm going to leave it on a massive cliffhanger, because I literally finished reading this book today. I closed the book and just went,
dun, this, dun, dun. Yeah.
I'm not going to spoil what happens, but cool. Something major is about to go down, and it's definitely worth checking out. And not only that, we did get the confirmation that there will be more Bat Trucks, so don't worry.
There will be more Bat Trucks, ladies and gentlemen. The chat likes it as well.
Good.
J-Man says it reminds him of the police trucks from the animated series. That's kind of what I saw in my head,
yeah.
Too, honestly. It's probably a throwback to there. So yeah, let's move on to the next topic of the day, which is actually the final comic of the evening. Old Man Logan, that's right. Old Man Logan, a personal favorite of mine, has continued on through Secret Wars, and stuff is starting to happen. It's getting kind of weird, man. Old Man Logan was originally penned by Mark Millar for Volume 1 and later picked up by Brian Michael Bendis, who has treated it with much care with regards to its world building and stuff like that. As previously predicted in other Let's Chats, I was thinking that Old Man Logan, you know, because he remembers much of the old world, he might end up kind of leading a team, telling them that, like, this world isn't the way that things are supposed to be. Anyway, James Howlett, our globe-trotting, reluctant, and tragic in times hero, continues his journey in Old Man Logan number 3. Gentlemen, I don't know if you have read Old Man Logan. Oh, and I know that you said you haven't.
Not Dylan, yet.
I don't know if you have, but oh my God, get out there and read it. It's amazing. The art is fantastic. The action scenes are great. It just plays out like the spaghetti western where it's like they have these panels where it's like you don't know what's going to happen. All of a sudden, death! You know, and just like it's surprising on every page, you flip it and just huge panels of snicked and blood everywhere. It's super gory. It's super bloody. A lot of our favorite characters end up dying horrible, horrible deaths. Some of our major players include the Hulk in the original Old Man Logan. There it is, Old Man Logan 3. Some of our players include Dr. Doom, obviously, in the newer things. I don't want to give away too many spoilers, but essentially there's a huge wall dividing all of the different worlds, and Logan decides to climb it in issue number 2. And issue 3 details what he finds on the other side of the wall, and as I said, as I predicted, he's starting to, like, talk to people and say, you don't remember me at all? You don't remember the X-Men? You don't remember any of that stuff? No, what? No. So it's starting to get really cool. It's almost like he's displaced in time or displaced in dimensions and universes, which is really cool. I'm really excited to see where the series goes. I'm a little worried, though, because we were talking a little bit before the show that, like, you know, Brian Michael Bendis, I used to really not like his work I was a huge Spider-Man fan. I liked him, like, his dynamic with Norman Osborn, the Green Goblin stuff, and all that stuff changed starting with Ultimate Spider-Man. I wasn't having it. But this new stuff, man, it's really cool. I can't deny, man. He's a good writer. According to a lot of other people that I speak with as well, he kind of drops off. He starts writing really well, and the endings kind of are lackluster, but I haven't really seen that as of yet. But I don't know. Dylan, what did you think of Old Man Logan?
I have been loving it so far. The first issue I thought started off really strong, and I was a little wary going into it because of Bendis. I love a lot of the stuff that Bendis does, but I know, especially recently, people have not been really loving what Bendis has been doing, but I went into it with an open mind, and I really liked it. The second issue kind of confused me, but it was probably just because I was tired when I was reading it.
But, yeah, I actually had to reread the second issue, too, because it actually jumps perspectives, and you don't realize that at first. That's kind of what confused me at first. What was confusing to you?
It was just like there were so many things happening, and I'm not too familiar with Age of Apocalypse and the X-Men universe and stuff. So
yeah.
It was just different for me, and especially with the art is beautiful in that book, but
oh, yeah.
Especially in the second issue when things are kind of muddy and everything's not spelled out for you, it just wasn't helping its case, I guess. But all in all, I'm loving the series so far. I think issue 3 is my favorite one.
Yeah. And it's really great because, like, the dialogue, Man, the words coming out of Logan's mouth in those bubbles are just amazing. It's just, you know, it's written out phonetically. You feel it, you know, you can hear him saying, you can hear the grizzle in his throat when he's talking about that, you know, it's just, it's so cool, man. I'm really excited to see it. And like, the way that I see it playing out is that, like, you know, we see on the all new, all different, all nude, all fantastic X-Men or Marvel or whatever, that, you know, old man Logan's kind of standing off in the corner, and he almost had like a supervisory pose or stance to him. Like, I've seen some things and I'm going to tell everybody about it. And I'm not necessarily going to fight no more, but, you know, I'll talk to you and I'll advise you. It seems like he's going to be some sort of teacher in the new Marvel. What do you guys think about that?
Somebody, I heard this, I don't know where I heard it, it may have been on Reddit or something, but, because the new, in that all-new, all-different Marvel poster thing where they have what's seemingly X-23 in the Wolverine costume, somebody said that, what if Old Man Logan was, like, X-23's mentor? And I just think that would be so cool.
That's what I'm saying. That's exactly what I'm saying, yeah.
That would be amazing. I would love that.
If you look at the cover for Extraordinary X-Men, which is the main X-Men team with, like, Storm and everyone. Old Man Logan is part of that X-Men team.
Oh, really?
So we don't know how this continuity is going to go. Is Xavier going to stay dead? Is Xavier coming back? Mm-hmm. What if this is an X-Men team formed by Old Man Logan instead of Xavier?
That's what I'm saying, because his immense popularity, you know? They're aging Logan. They want Logan to now look old so they can maybe try to hold on to Hugh Jackman to continue playing him, you know? honestly, that's what I think. I think they're going to try to hold on to him and be like, all right, so you don't want to be Logan anymore because you have to work out too much, right? Dig this. We're going to let you get old.
Fat Wolverine.
Yeah, you got that dad bod Wolverine now. All right, so that's what I think about Old Man Logan. I say pick up every friggin' issue you can. It's fantastic. Don't wait for the trade. It's just, I usually don't like cliffhangers, and I don't like waiting in between issues, but, like, it's just, I can't wait to get my hands on the next one, man. I really can't. So we're going to move on to our next topic of the day, which is our fandom fight powered by nerdfeed.com. That's right. We actually pit up Black Widow versus Daredevil in this week's fandom fight. We put this up yesterday and it got some votes in, and I look at it now, it's actually split down the middle, which is crazy. This is updated in real time, so 5-5 is pretty crazy. I was expecting Daredevil to get a bunch of votes, honestly.
Really?
So yeah, I thought he was gonna take it, but I definitely believe that Black Widow could whip his ass. But we're talking about the MCU versions. Like, yes, I know that they were married in the comics and stuff like that, but I just want to show one inciting incident for this fight, and then I'll let you gentlemen take it away. That right there. That is what caused the fandom fight that we're doing today. Daredevil slapping Black Widow's ass and her calling him a male chauvinist. That's why they're fighting. They're fighting to the death. And like I said, it's split down the middle, 5-5. Owen, who do you think is going to take this fight?
Okay. What if he's blind? He might not have meant to do that. He could have been trying to grab that cabinet there.
No. The dialogue, look, the dialogue says, so why don't you slip into something barely legal? I want my date to be the most gorgeous thing at the party. I said, move it, darling, slap.
That's a lawyer joke. Come on.
Damn it, Matt Murdock. Yeah. That's like what I'm going to call the lower half Hank Pym.
Yeah.
But on a serious note,
we're seeing two people fight to the death, man. We should not be giggling.
But just looking at the MCU counterparts, it's got to be Black Widow. She's a trained assassin. You know, she's been raised in the Red Room since she was the age of 9. You know, she is. You know, she's killed. She's taken lives. She is one of the most dangerous people in the Marvel Universe. And no disrespect to Daredevil. Daredevil's an incredible fighter. He's trained by Stick. He's trained by the Chase. Daredevil is awesome. But Black Widow.
He's a bad mofo, but as Black right now, Widow. I'm talking about the current, like, MCU versions.
Well,
know,
even
as
in
they
that.
Stand now.
Well, even in that, you know, Daredevil's trained by Stick, who heads the Chase. You know, he's still a master of the arts of ninjutsu. And he's the son of a boxer, so he can probably take a punch. Mm-hmm. That being said, Black Widow is a naturally trained assassin. And she's probably the most dangerous assassin in the Marvel Universe. So you can't really bet against her.
Yeah, I mean, I think honestly a more even fight would be her and Gamora, honestly, in a hand-to-hand fight, because like this version of Gamora in the MCU is kind of like really depowered compared to the other one. Like she's not doesn't appear to be super strong. She doesn't appear to be able to like jump over a bunch of shit and stuff like that. She appears to be like an average person, kind of like of Black Widow's ability. Dylan, what do you think? Who's gonna take this fight?
I got one little sentence for you. Black Widow took on Ultron. Daredevil had trouble with like 12 guys in a hallway.
There you go. Ooh. There you go, man. That's my argument, is that this is pretty a much. Young Daredevil. At this point in the MCU, he can barely fight 12 guys in a hallway. Yeah.
If I can just interject, what would make a really interesting fight is the two most deadliest assassins in the Marvel Universe. Black Widow versus the Winter Soldier.
Ooh.
No, she already lost the Winter Soldier.
But why didn't I get told about this?
You didn't see Captain America Winter Soldier?
Oh. That wasn't like a full-on fight, though.
She would have died. If that fight wasn't stopped, if like Cap didn't interject, she would have been dead. But, I mean, I guess if we're talking like straight up hand-to-hand, like he did have an assault rifle.
I want to see like hand-to-hand, full-on.
Right.
Widower. Yeah, no cheating.
So that might have to be our next fandom fight. I'm going to go ahead and read off some comments that we got off of Nerdfeed. Some very cool, generous people went ahead and donated their comments to us today. We got Bob Dole, great name. Bob Dole with the Captain America picture. Daredevil all the way. His enhanced senses give him the edge here. They are basically a superpower. Agreed. He does have that superpower, but I mean, you know, Dylan said it best, like 12 people in the hallway whipped his ass. He won in the end, but Black Widow wouldn't have any trouble with those guys. And like you've seen her in the films walking around taking out just armed guys, you know, hand to hand. Who else do we got here? We got Phoenix Rising. Well, if we're going by the movie verse here, which we should, Black Widow has been doing this much longer, which is indeed true. She would have 10 times the experience that Daredevil would have. And I think that she could take him down. I have to agree with that. I think she has a lot more experience. She took down Ultron, you know, a bunch of Ultron bots. She was rocking the shit. I can't believe that people go ahead and say, like, oh, she's useless. She does nothing. Like, no, she was kind of kicking a lot of ass in Ultron. I beg to differ, you know what I mean? Her and Cap were a really great team. I like how they were fighting together and, like, playing off of each other. So there it is. Right now it is split down the middle. We have no idea who's going to win. You got to go over to Nerdfeed right now and go ahead and vote and let us know. We will be judging the winner next week. So who do we have here right now? I voted Black Widow. Owen, who do you vote?
I voted Black Widow.
You voted Black Widow, and Dylan, you also said Black Widow?
Yep.
So that's us from Let's Chat Comics. That's what we say. Black Widow takes the fight. Right on. So that's going to do it for the show. It was so much fun. I don't want to say goodbye.
While we're still here, there's a couple of little bits of news.
Absolutely. What do we have for news, Owen?
Let's break it down quickly. Badass Digest are reporting that KG Beast is going to be making an appearance in Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, played by Captain America Winter Soldier actor Callan Mulvey. For those of you who aren't aware of who he is, the guy sports a rather fetishist costume and displays super strength and agility thanks to cybernetic enhancements, and he's a trained assassin. And the rumour is that he's going to be Lex Luthor's personal hitman in the film. The second rumour comes from the other faithful Latino Review, which is claiming that Jenna Malone's character in Batman Superman is indeed Barbara Gordon Oracle.
So my money's on Carrie Kelly, but go on.
The third piece is a slight bit of humour. It's been making the rounds of a fake, real, we don't know, Spider-Man cast list. I'm sure you've all seen it. The one that says that Hugh Laurie is confirmed to be J. Jonah Jameson.
I haven't seen that. Where is this list?
It's all over the interweb. Really? I think it's Heroic Hollywood.
I've been working on the show all damn day. I haven't been attached, because then I'm going to like make the show late.
Yeah, Heroic. I think it's Heroic Hollywood reporting.
Oh, man, man.
So anyway, I've done some digging. My source has given me an exclusive on the cast list for Spider-Man. Let me read it out to you. The role of Peter Parker / Spider-Man will be played by none other than Tom Holland. The role of Aunt May will be played by Marissa Tomei. The role of Uncle Ben. Role of Uncle Ben will be played by Kevin James.
Get the fuck out of here.
No,
I'm gone. I'm done. Bye, everybody.
The role.
I feel like you've done this to me already, Owen.
We're not done. We still have a couple more. The role of Dr. Otto Octavius will be played by Ed Helms.
What?
Yeah, you could stop right there, dude.
No, we have three more. I spent ages on this. The role of Matt Gargan, a.k.a. Scorpion, will be played by Pixel star Adam Sandler.
No!
The role of Norman Osborn will be played by Will Ferrell. And finally, the role of J. Jonah Jameson will be played by Nicolas Cage.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Sounds like an SNL skit.
You heard
Actually,
it here
I would
first.
See Kevin James get shot if that's...
That's I was going to say that, too.
All right, guys. So we're running a little long here, so we're going to cut the show short. Actually, not short, long. It's like the 30th time I've said this. Anyway, Dylan, thank you so much for joining us on the show. It was a blast.
Me.
Hope to do it again sometime. Where can they find you on the interwebs?
You can go to youtube.com/Aurum, A-U-R-A-M, chaos, or I'm on Twitter at Aurum Alexander.
Right on. And do you have anything to plug? Any new shows coming out? Any new videos?
Well, I guess I could... Look over here. Since Fantastic Four is coming out next week, I will be doing a Parallels segment on Reed Richards where I talk about alternate universe versions of characters. So.
Awesome. Yeah, I really like that show, man. I like the one that you did on the Hulk. It's a great one.
Thank you.
Yeah. Cool, man. So, Owen, where can they find you on the interwebs?
You can find me on Twitter at OwenLikesComics and on YouTube at youtube.com/C/OwenLikesComics. This week, we'll be talking Development Hell Discussions, the show I explain comic book film scripts that were produced but never came to fruition, where myself, Baron Von Comics, and Better Call Me, will be explaining just why Batman and Superman are arguing over beers and sodas. Make sure to check that out on Friday.
Awesome. And of course, you can always find Owen over here at Let's Chat. Let's Chat Comics, Let's Chat Movies, Let's Chat Games. Yes, that's all three of them. Let's Chat Movies, Let's Chat Comics, Let's Chat Games. On Twitch.tv/GolemVision, you can also find the shows edited up and cut up for your viewing pleasure into like little bite-sized digestible segments. On YouTube.com/GolemVision, you can also find it on Owen's channel, as well as El Cheapo Nerd Comics, El Cheapo Games, and a few other places. Just search for us. Anyway, thanks so much for joining us on the show. Thanks so much for our special guest, Dylan. Thanks so much to Owen. And thank you to our moderator in the chat, Sal. Thank you for NerdSync for showing up. Aaron Bess, J-Man, Longtar, everybody out there that's watching us and everybody that's going to watch it in the future. Thanks so much for watching. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thanks, guys.
Make sure to watch Let's Chat Comics every Thursday, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Follow us on Twitter at GoldenVision, at Jacobs_TalkBox, at Owen Likes Comics, and at Baron Von Comics. Hashtag Let's Chat. Hashtag Comics. This edition of Let's Chat was powered by Nerdfeed. Nerdfeed.com, the greatest and largest growing social nerdwork in the universe. And possibly the first. Subscribe today for free. If you like this video, make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. It does wonders, and it lets us know how you feel about the content we produce. We make better content if you give us feedback. Thanks!